Very good. Okay, so welcome everybody. So we start our Victoria Probability Seminar, and today our speaker is Professor Vladimir Matveyev from Friedrich Schiller University of Vienna. The talk appeared on our schedule quite unexpectedly because Professor Matveyev is visiting La Trobe University, and I just met him somewhere in the corridor. And we stuck talking, and his area is geometry, but he did some stuff which is related to stochastics and probability processes. And I just suggested that maybe he can give talk to our seminar, and it would be interesting and probably a little bit outside of our comfort zone, and we will learn some new things about geometry. So Professor Matveyev, after he completed his PhD, he got several postdocs in Europe, in France, in Cambridge, in Max Planck Institute of Mathematics and other places. Then he moved as a professor to University of Leuven, and now he's in Germany. And at the same time, he's visiting La Trobe University because he has some connections with us. So one of attendees today is Professor Nikolayevsky. They have joint IRC grant. And finally, I just would like just briefly describe Vladimir's area of research. He's mainly working in differential geometry, global analysis, also some topics related to topology and Hamiltonian systems. And today his talk will be probably on boundary between probability and geometry. So we will take this geometric challenge, and Vladimir, you are very welcome.
Thank you very much, Andrei. It is indeed a great honor for me to speak at the seminar because I am rather from geometry and not from anything related to probability, stochastics, statistics, and so on. It is joint result with two guys. So Ilya Pavlikevich is the one who knows everything about stochastic processes. And Tian Yuma is the one who did all the work on this joint paper, but I will also mention some older results, including those with Mark Troyanov and Yuri Nikolayevsky, who is present in the Zoom session. Here is the plan of my talk. So that it is indeed a boundary of two signs. So I need to give two sets of definition. For geometers, I recall the standard stuff for people doing stochastic processes. What is random walk? What is Brownian motion? For people from other side, I recall what is a Fisler metric? What are geodesics? And then I combine these two topics together by generalizing random walks and Brownian motion to the Fislerian setup. Actually, the definitions is very straightforward, and the remaining case is the case where most results were already done. We generalize them for Fislerian case. I still try to explain why the results were expected and also comment on proofs. And if the times allow, I will also go in another direction and give applications of what we get within the stochastic processes in Fislerian geometry. In the case you have questions, please stop me, ask me. I love to answer questions during the talk. So what is the standard flat random walk? The definition appeared in a paper of Pearson published in Nature in 1905. It was not a paper, but rather a question to the audience. And the definition which can be extracted from the question is the follows. So we consider the following stochastic process on Rn. So in this case, the manifold, the configuration space was the usual Rn. So we take an interval from 0 to 1, divided into n equal subintervals. On the picture, n is equal to 3, first subinterval, second, third. And then walk according to the following procedure. We start with point P, take the random direction, go the distance 1 divided square root of n. Then at this new point, take the new running direction, go again the same distance, and so on. On the picture, we have n equal to 1^2. We then reparameterize this broken line such that the time of going is the same, so one, or you can do it, of course, for any number of any number here, not necessarily one. And so the middle of this line on the picture is somewhere here. Now, if you do the big N, the picture starts to look as follows. Here is a picture for N equal to 50. Here is for N equal to 1000. And the right picture, the picture on the right-hand side is probably the standard picture of the Brownian motion you have seen everywhere. So the properties which I would like to keep within the talk is the follows. Any trajectory is continuous curve. The number of points where it's not smooth grows with n in the limit that we will know points of smoothness almost for almost all trajectories. And the length of the trajectory, the scaling is done such that the length of the trajectory goes to infinity if n goes to infinity. So in the finite time, the trajectory is still infinite long when n goes to infinity. Now, the standard Brownian motion, one of many equivalent definition, is the limit of Pearson random walks if n goes to infinity. The word limit will be explained on the next slide, but it's not the only definition which one can give. And I would say probably the most textbook has so-called axiomatic definition. The standard Brownian motion, or actually most people used Wiener process for it, can be characterized by properties. So we start at P. W has independent increments. So the future increment is independent on the past. The increments are Gaussian with mean zero and variance U. And W has continuous paths, and these properties, they're properties, just the properties determined by known theorem, the stochastic process uniquely. And it's the same stochastic process which is obtained as a sequence, as a limit of the sequence of random walks. Let me now comment on the word limit. So the limit is done in the weak sense. So that means that for continuous bounded functional phi, which is a function on the space of continuous trajectories. So it maps trajectories to numbers. We consider phi of xn, xn is the trajectory, and expectation. So xn is a random trajectory. Yeah, so it depends on how we gamble on the way we appear different number with deep trajectories. So phi will have different values, but expectation is a well-defined object. So there are many functionals on the space of curves. Simplest are possibly we take three points and sum the values of some function and these three points. We say that the stochastic process converge to some other stochastic process in the weak sense if the expectations converge for n to infinity. So it's some kind of convergence with respect to the measure. So I am done with stochastic part of my talk, space definition of my talk. In the case somebody, especially from geometers, would like have the question, please stop me and ask. I will try to follow whatever it is. I think the microphone is on for everybody, so we simply can simply interrupt. And now I given to geometric parts of the definition. So I give definition of Fisler matrix. I will work on manifold, but in fact, I mean, manifold can be simply said to be thought to be a subset of Rn, open subset of Rn. Topology is not relevant for my talk. then Finster metric as an object is a function f, which is real valued functions, which is defined on the tangent bundle. So you know, to get a number from f, you need to plug a point from the manifold, but also a vector, so a vector tangent to the manifold at this point, such that the following condition are fulfilled. For every point p, if you consider the function fp, which is a restriction of f to the tangent vectors at the point p, then this function f is a so-called Minkowski norm. That means that it is homogeneous. F of lambda times v is lambda times f of v. It is convex. F of sum is not greater than the sum of f's. And it is definite. F is equal to zero if and only if the vector we plugged in is equal to v zero. The word Minkowski before the word of norm tells us that F is not necessarily completely homogeneous. It's only positive homogeneous. So the lambda which we put inside in the first property is required to be positive. So for example, if we make the unit ball in this norm F, it is not necessary to be symmetric. It is convex, but the length of the vector v and the length of the vector minus v is not always the same. So just if you would like to have a geometric imagination, then some people would think about Finster metrics as a field of convex body. So this gray is our manifold. And then at every point we have a norm attached. So basically we can try to make a picture of this Finster metric by making the unit balls at all the points. Of course, on the picture, we can do it only as finitely many as I did, but it also already probably gives geometric impression what is Finster metric. This way is indeed used by some geometers, and it is very reasonable to think this way, but possibly for our talk, it's better to think about analytic approach to Finster metric, and since that Finster metric is nothing else as way to measure the length of the vector and therefore the length of the curves and therefore the distances between points. So given a point P and tangent vector V, we can define its length just F of P of V. It's not necessarily symmetric. F of P V and F of P minus V is not all the same, but otherwise it satisfies everything you would like to require from the lengths. And with the help of this F, you can measure the length of the curves by the usual integral formula. So for the curve C, we define its length as integral of F of C, a point C of the length of C prime of t, of the velocity vector. Because of homogeneity property, because f of lambda v is lambda f of v, the length doesn't depend on parameterization, as you probably expect from the length. Next, we define the distance between two points as infinitum of set of lengths of the curves connecting these points. So the distance, so basically, if you have two points, one and two, then the distance is we take all the curves connected, parameter is not important, and the distance is the shortest curve. It exists, and if it doesn't exist, just the infinitum of the set of the length of the possible curves. It is definite, so distance is non-zero if points are different. It's satisfies by trivial reason the triangle inequality, because the shortest curve which connect these two points is shorter than the one connecting these two points and these two points. It is not symmetric though, so distance from P to Q is not necessary from distance Q to P, but it is rather advantage than disadvantage because it allows to use Finster metrics in more general situations. finally, we define geodesics as locally shortest curves, which means that geodesic is the shortest curve connecting two points. Or equivalently, one can say this as the property that length of gamma restricted to T1, T2 is the distance between gamma of T1, gamma of T2. Definition of distance precisely means geodesic, that if this property satisfies, then this is the shortest curve. Let me give a few examples which you know. And one example is just the usual Euclidean structure. And the message is that Euclidean structure is a special case of Finsler structure, because one can obtain it by considering the following Finsler metric. Finsler metric is where you plug point, but the formula will not depend on the point and vector, and the depends on the vector simply the square of the sum of the square root of the sums of the squares of component of the vector. So the standard norm of the vector V. It is smooth, of course, homogeneous. If you multiply V by lambda, lambda goes outside, satisfies the triangle inequality. So it is a Finsler matrix. In this case, geodetic are just straight lines, and the distance is the usual Euclidean distance. One can do it slightly more complicated and consider Riemannian structure. It is also a special case of Finsler structure. So let us start with the Riemannian metric, which for those who do forget what it is, it's just a field of positive definite n times n matrices, n is our dimension, whose components gij smoothly depend on the coordinate which I called x. And then define Finsler metric f by the following formula. Would g be the unit matrix, the matrix where on diagonal we have constant one and otherwise we have zero, we simply get the formula for the Euclidean Finsler structure. It's also evidently smooth, it's also evidently homogeneous, and it's also evidently convex, so it is Finsler metric. So in this geodesic, in this case, are usually Riemannian geodesics. They can be equivalent defined as solution of the ordinary differential equation, which is a standard equation of geodesic. So you see the unknown function in the system of ODEs are gammas. It is n unknown functions and equations. And the equation is nonlinear, it's quadratic actually in first derivative. And the coefficients of the equation, which I call here gamma, they are given by, they are given by explicit formulas in G. So this is the known formula for the coefficient gamma. These coefficients are called components of the Levitch-Witte connections. So because of known theorem about ordinary differential equation at every point, at any direction, there exists precisely one geodesic starting from this point in this direction. So let me just say about a few words about history. The history goes back to at least to Cartiodori, who also with a group of mathematicians around him is the founder of the optimization theory somewhere in the middle, in the break between 19th and 20th century. And what he observed that for many optimization problems, one can assume this functional is homogeneous. So it is a known observation in many sciences. For example, in classical mechanics, it's called as Mapertuis principle. So he restricted his consideration to functions which are homogeneous, which are more or less the same as Finsler metrics. And his program was to adapt mathematical tools which were very effective somewhere around this time, maybe slightly earlier. Affine connection, a Jacobi vector field sectional curvature to this more general setup. So the program was partially carried out by Paul Finsler, who was student of Cartiodori and then later became a professor and studied some other science. Now the possible application of Finsler metrics. So they can be used to describe so-called anisotropic background. So Romanian medics describe background such that they depend, our Euclidean structure depends on position. And Pfister metric is that describe background where even in the point, the structure depends not only position, but on the direction. Yeah. So the backgrounds where they are used include light propagation, certain media, then remain metric not enough, fire propagation, so under influence of wind and slope, fuel gives you more or less remain background, but if you have wind and slope, then the law of propagation of fire can very well be modeled with the help of Pfister metrics. Or, for example, effects of currents and wind in marine navigation. It's also Pfister metric is more convenient to describe this than other places. So let me speak about Pfister geodesic. They have the property we have seen in the Riemannian and Euclidean example. So at every point, in every direction, there exists precisely one geodesic. They describe by ODE, which is of second order, such that it is nonlinear. And actually, in this case, nonlinearity is even worse than the Riemannian case because it's not only quadratic, but also the coefficient, which I also call gamma, and which are given by some formula I do not show, are given by algebraic expression in first and second partial derivative of f. But still, there are some second order differential equation in the background. So let me just locate me in my talk. So I recall definition of standard flat random walk. I recalled what I would like you to know about Pfister metric. And now I will generalize random walk and Brownian motion to Pfisterian manifolds. Actually, generalization is pretty much straightforward. So what I did here, I copy-paste my slide about definition of random walks Brownian motion, and now I simply change it. I change straight lines by geodesics. Yeah. So this part is not a straight line, but it's geodesic of F. There is one more, otherwise everything is the same. There is one more thing which we need to discuss, namely, so when we worked with the standard Pearson random walk, the random direction at every point was more or less the same random direction. We take one measure here, we even could take the standard uniformly distributed null direction measure. And then by parallel translation, we put it in every point. Now in the physical background, this way is not natural. So let me discuss the random direction on the next slide. There are different ways to think about the problem. One can try to choose the random direction such that it is natural for the Pfister situation. In this case, there are also many natural random directions because there are many probability measure on the tangent bundle constructed canonically by F. Canonically means by coordinate independent procedure. Let me give two examples. One can take the following probability measure. We consider the one ball in our Pfister norm. So this is example of one ball. And then one can take the probability measure, which is identically distributed on the one ball. It's proportional to the area of our set with the coefficient proportionality such that the measure of the whole one ball is one, as it should be for the probability measure. There are also other choices. So another choice could be the following. We consider the so-called fundamental tensor, which is simply the second differential divided by two, which doesn't matter, of the square of the Pfister function. It is a positive definite matrix, and the volume form corresponding to this positive definite matrix, so the standard volume form multiplied by the determinant, is another suggestion from the canonical measure constructed by Fissler metric. Each choice of the measure corresponds to a random walk, and they correspond to a different random walk. But actually, this canonical choice is not always probably the best one, because in applications, the measure is in most cases not canonical. It doesn't come from the Fissler metric by geometric construction because of just the different natures. The Fissler structure is usually due to anisotropies or at the infinitesimal level, but the probability measure is due to some fast movement of anything else, and may come, say, from the standard Euclidean structure. So what I'm discussing now is how the probability measure, the choice of probability measure on the space of direction, influence the Brownian motion. I will first give answer in the remaining case. The answer is classical one. And then you will see a similar answer in the Fisslerian case. So let mu be a probability measure on the tangent space. Mu x means that it is a measure on the set of direction in the on the tangent vectors to the point x. We always assume that the center for simplicity. In the paper, we also deal with other case, which means that expectation of mu is zero. And then consider the so-called covariance bilinear form. So as if you forget about the probability background, it is just symmetric bilinear form sigma on the cotangent bundle, so on the forms, given as follows. Sigma of 2-1 form is given integral of alpha of y, beta of y, mu of x, dy, where y goes in our manifold. So if this mu is a probability measure, this guy still can be infinite, but under some technical assumptions. So second momentum should be finite. It is finite thing, everything's well defined. If you prefer to work in coordinates, the formula which stays here, it just this very easy formula. So you integrate quadratic function over our measure space. So the theorem due to Jorgensen is the follows. Under certain quite mild additional assumption on mu's and on g's, so assumptions are indeed mild, the sequence of remaining random walks converge to a continuous Markovian process whose generator is given by this formula. So first of all, let me repeat, at least for geometers, that generators is being a second order operator determines continuous Markovian process. And this one is indeed a second order operator. So it acts on functions on the manifold and builds them to a functions. And this construction, so the operator is, so the sigma ij is a bilinear form which is at every point given by the covariant matrix. It is construct only by the measure, by the formula which recall here. And g here and here, let me just clear the one, and g here and here is information coming from the metric. And you see we differentiate our function to time, so it is second order operator. Yeah, its symbol is sigma ij, and it is positively definite under mild assumption on the measure mu. Thus, in order to understand the global behavior of—
Oh, may I ask a quick question, sorry. So mu, your choice for the measure and your choice for the metric are generally independent. They satisfy some mild conditions, I assume some analytic conditions, but they're just two independent objects, right?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
So in order to understand low behavior particles whose movement is described by Riemann-Brown motion, one should simply solve the heat PDE, so which is parabolic PDE, given by this one. So derivative of u respect of t is equal by my elliptic operator applied to t. There is a very well developed theory. Now, different from Fislinian case, since canonical construction of invariant measure must be in very respect to group SOG, if the Riemann measure is canonical, if it's canonically constructed by the metric, the corresponding generator must necessarily be a constant multiple of the plus operator. The constant, it depends on the construction, but it's constant, the same constant for all points of the manifold. So the heat equation is just a standard Riemann heat equation. And in this case, also there exists a very well-developed theory how to work this equation, this property, and so on. Let me go now go to the Fislerian case. So I will formulate my main theorem, and I will give its two versions. First one in words, and then I give some formulas. So the informal version is the following. After additional assumption on the Fislerian metric, and on mu, which I give below for formal reason, the system of Fislerian random walks converge to a continuous Markovian process whose generator is elliptic differential operator of second order whose symbol is the covariance bilinear form. So you see that the symbol of the operator is the same. It depends only on the measure. The linear terms, the lower order terms are influenced by the Fislerian background, and later I will give the formula and comment on them, how they influence the background. So the generator of the Fislerian-Brownian motion is, one can view it as Laplace of the pyramidal operator generated by the metric generated by sigma plus linear terms. And linear terms, one can view them as linear differential operators. The coefficient is naturally then a vector field. They behave as a vector field if we change the coordinate system. And they actually called drift. It has a clear physical meaning. It just corresponds very clearly to a wind blowing with velocity AI, so it is component of those vectors, and it moves the solution tensorly with the velocity AI. In particular, it's very hard to distinguish experimentally Fislerian-Brown motion from a Riemann one, and this was observed before experimentally. So in the Fislerian situation, in the case of anisotropic background, one did experiments and one always see Riemannian-Brown motion, and our result explains why it is the case. I will, of course, give the explicit formula. The formula for symbol you already know, it's the usual covariance, but I also will give formula for the drift. Let me first formalize everything. I will shortly, fastly go through additional assumption on the Fislerian metric and on the form of mu I. So I assume that M is connected for a complete area geodesic can be prolonged infinitely, so it doesn't stop. F is smooth, strictly convex. Now, this complicated assumption is that the manifold has bounded geometry in the following sense. Possibly, I will skip this part. I will not pronounce this part. There are some technical conditions which we need to use in order to the proofs are mathematically correct. Yeah. We don't know whether the conditions are sufficient. We don't have counterexample if the conditions are fulfilled. But if you forget about the precise formulation of the conditions, first of all, they require only first and second derivative of the Fislerian metric. It is first property of all conditions here. And second, if the manifold is compact, then any smooth strictly convex Fislerian metric has bounded geometry. So the condition is fulfilled on compact manifolds, and some people say that, well, if everything is fulfilled for compact, then in practice, it's always fulfilled. I don't know what's the case, but at least it is so. Now the assumption of mu, we assume that mu smoothly depend on the point. And for simplicity, we assume that it either resides inside the unit balls in the physical metric bell, or it resides on the indicator trees, which means that the direction we take either has length less than one in our F, or simply has length equal to one. What we don't want is that the length is too high, because we do not want to allow two big jumps of our Finsler walks. Yeah. We also assume that mu is centered, which is means that expectation is zero, but I already told about it. Now, let me give you the precise formula for the generator of the Titlerian motion. What you should see here is a differential operator of second order. The function where I apply this operation is f. So af is also a function. I should give its value in the point p. And you see here is the second order term. So it is the second order derivative summed with the coefficient, and coefficients are just the coefficient of the covariant matrix. I didn't write the summation here, probably should do it in general geometric summation with respect to I and J is assumed. Yeah. So this is the coefficient of the symbols, and there the additional linear term you see they applied to the first derivative. So this is our vector drift. I call it AI in the previous slide. Now gambas are so entries of so-called Finslerian Christoffel symbols. They are explicit expression in Finsler matrix and its derivative up to second. So the symbol is just the covariant matrix. The symbol of A corresponds to this coincides with the symbol of the time the last operator corresponding to sigma viewed as a Riemann metric. Let me explain why second order differential operator appeared as generator. This would work for any smooth Finsler metric. It is possible that results are weighted in different assumptions. So the assumptions which of our technical nature and will use for mathematical correct proof. So the next slide, I repeat definition of generator. Consider generators of Finsler-Randolph's walk and explain that they converge to an elliptic operator. The generator of continuous stochastic Markov process is defined as follows. So it is limit for t to zero, t minus identity, where t is the pseudo operator applied to our function f. So I didn't write down the definition of tt. Tt is integral of the endpoints of x xp. So you consider all endpoints where you can go with respect to of your stress process. You integrate over all possible endpoint with the corresponding probability, and the result will be tt of fp. Endpoint would be t1, at the point t, it would be t. As I said, generator determines the Markovian stochastic process with continuous trajectories. For the standard Brownian motion, generator is just the Laplace operator divided by two. So I claimed above that for Finsler Brownian motion generators, again, elliptic second order operator, and I explain why it's expected. So let us denote by gamma geodesic. P and y is the initial point and the initial velocity vector. And let us go the time one divides, so one step of our work, one divides square root of n. Then by definition, this an of fp is the limit for n goes to an infinity f, where we take the point integrate over the mu minus f of p divided by 1 divided by n. What I did here, I put instead of this guy, the Taylor extension, Taylor series for this guy up to the second terms. Because P is just the point. This is the velocity vector, it is copied from here. And what here is the second order derivative, and we know second order derivative because we know differential equation for geodesics. So this comes from the second derivative, which we know from the equation of geodesic. And the smaller terms are smaller terms. Yeah. So I rewrote it again and I put some colors, and you see that the colors are such that so this guy and this guy cancel. This guy is zero because our measure is centered. So this is just zero. And what remains is the blacks. And it's precisely the formula which I have shown you in the previous slide. So this is quite easy argument. I did not use anything but Taylor expansion and also geodetic of expansion geodetic. And of course, it is too easy to be new. So for special choice of measures was discussed in, 20 years ago and also before. So the challenge was proof that the sequence of random walks converged to continuous process and the generator of the process is the limit of the generators. And this would do the job. So let me explain how we did it. So I think I did everything here. So I will comment on proofs, and the challenge is to give some applications for linear geometry, or maybe I will have no time for it. Let me comment on proofs. So the one technical note that the Pearson random walk is not Markovian, because say for n equal to 3, not 1 divided by 3, and t equal to half, the history determines future for some time of t. Markovian if the history has no influence on the future. And Pearson random walk is not Markovian. Let us make it Markovian. It is a very standard method. We first discretize the time. So if this was our initial random walk, so the red line is our M. So our M of the picture is one dimensional, or you may think that the red line is big dimensional manifold. So you randomly choose direction. And this black line is time. So it's slightly different pictures than the one I have shown to you because now I put time as one of the coordinates. Then it was our initial walk and now each time steps are now one. The one is digitization. We stay here for a second, then jump here, stay here for the second, jump here, stay here for the second. So the nodes are the same, but we simply jump and do not go continuously. And the third case is randomization of the time. So the time is not always 1, 1, 1, but we randomize them according to Poisson process. Yeah. And by this trick, the process is not continuous anymore, but now with Markov process, it has additional advantages. Now we prove that the sequence of this randomization, Markovization of our problem is tight, which means that they exist. So it is, I believe, standard condition for people doing stochastic processes. So this K is now a subset of continuous passes on M. And we claim that they exist a compact subset for any epsilon, for any T, such that probability that our random walk for time less than t stay in this compact subset is big enough. So having tightness plays the role of precompactness. I mean, it's even compact. So if it's tight, then the we have the conversion by the standard result. And in order to prove the tightness, we used the standard two-step procedure. The first is compact containers condition, which means that our random walk does not leave compact almost for with sufficiently big probability, so it doesn't go too fast to infinity. And second, so-called Aldous, I don't know how to pronounce this, his name, criteria. So I probably would be fast on this point, but let me just, first of all, that known theorem having this and this imply tightness, and then we are done. And second, that both of the part, this part and this part are non-trivial analytic proofs, which deeply use the geometry on manifolds, in particular, strongly use the technical condition I assumed on our thesis. For example, boundedness of geometry. If it's not bounded, it simply failed. So one can construct some counterexample, quite artificial, but still the examples. Yeah. So let me now check the time. So you prefer me to stop now, or you prefer me to speak a bit about Fisslerian geometry?
Well, maybe before you speak 5 minutes, it would be okay, and then you will have 5 minutes also for questions.
I will try to be faster than 5 minutes, but maybe I do not keep my promise. And now I give to Fisslerian geometry. And it appears that this construction gives immediately some construction which was recently discovered and which solved few problems in Fisslerian geometry. So this construction viewed from the viewpoint of stochastic process is as follows. Given a Fisslerian metric, we construct a smooth Riemann metric on the same manifold. So it's a functor from Fisslerian manifolds to Riemann manifolds. It's actually projections are same that it is identical on Riemann manifolds. We do it as follows. We take Fisslerian metric and consider A or Z probability measure canonical construct on the tension space. It is identically distributed on the one wall, and the probability to land in the gray region is proportional to the usual Lebesgue volume. So it's probability, so the whole volume is one. One can also slightly generalize it, so it works also for Fisslerian metric, which is not symmetric with respect to origin. Then this choice of the measure gives us Fisslerian Brownian motion, and therefore generator. And this procedure of generator is coordinate invariant procedure. If we change coordinate system, the generator changes as a tensor with two upper indexes. This guy, the generator, the symbol generator, is a Riemann metric. It's contravariant Riemann metric, so inverse of the usual Riemann metric. Its smoothness is at least as high as that of F. We call this metric Binelli-Legendre metric. It appears actually before our paper for stochastic flows. The name Binelli-Legendre is because its corresponding sphere is a Binelli-Legendre ellipsoid construct by the unit ball of F. Binelli-Legendre ellipsoid is something coming from mechanics. Legendre is a guy working in 1850s. Binet was working in 1870s. And the construction was done in a joint paper with Mark Troyanov. So I applied this functorial construction of Riemann metrics by Fisslerian metric to prove some, I would say, big theorem, but it's my theorem, so probably should be more modest. It is Myers-Steenhoff theorem for Fisslerian manifolds low regularity. So the question the theory answers is the follows. We have two Fisslerian manifolds, M1, M2, And the fourth phi is isometry, so it preserves the distances. You remember that Fisler many metric defined distances. Now suppose our metrics are not very smooth, say only Hölder continues. Yeah, what is the lowest possible smoothness of the isometry? The theorem is that any distant preserver, so any isometry in the terminology of the question, bijective map with Hölder continuous Fisler metrics is diffeomorphism, so at least C1 smooth. Moreover, if the metrics of class CK alpha, K is differential smoothness and alpha is the Hölder, with K is any natural number, possibly zero, alpha is any number from 0 to 1, such that either K or alpha is greater than 0, then diffeomorphism is of class K plus 1 differential, and the K plus 1 derivative is alpha Hölder. Theorem is sharp. One cannot get better regularity. There is a counterexample for this zero metric. Special cases were proved before by different people, some of which are very famous. And the Fisler metric is very mild assumption on it, may be reversible, maybe not strictly convex, which is different from all other results, which really require reversibility and strictly convexity. The scheme of the proof is the following. Fisler isometry induced isometry of the Binet-Legendre metrics. Binet-Legendre metric is at least as smooth as initial Fisler one, because therefore it is sufficient to prove the theorem for Riemannian metrics, and it was done in the series of a great result before us. So once we have the reduction of the question for Fislerian metrics to the question for Riemannian metrics, we are done, because clever people did this job for us. So that's more or less it. I believe I have to stop now. So let me stop now. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Vladimir, for a very comprehensive talk and many, at least for me, new things. Okay, now we have time for some questions. So if you have questions, please unmute yourself and just ask.
I have one sort of elementary question. If you have a non-centered probability distribution, do you just get extra drift, or are there more complicated things that happen?
Okay, very good question. So let me just try to answer it on the whiteboard. So I closed my, I have problems with sharing the whiteboard. Have technical problems with probably I need to share my whiteboard. I need to give my tablet possibility to do it, right? No, it is given possibility.
Okay, so we can see something, yeah, okay.
But you don't see what I want you to show.
Okay.
So for this.
Okay.
Okay, let me kick me myself out.
Maybe if you don't need to write a lot, you can write on your PDF like you did before. Yeah, just
yes,
make some empty space.
Different. Okay, so. So just let me give you the first version of the answer of your question. So what happens if the measure is not centered? Yeah. So basically, suppose that the probability to go to the right is higher than the probability of go to the left. Yeah, it will be in one dimensional case a typical example of not centered measure. Then if you do two steps, then the estimation is that you go to the right, just a bit. And if you give 1,000 steps, then the estimation is you go to the right very fast. Yeah. So basically, if you just repeat the same definition, but in the non-centered measure, you escape to infinity in no time. Yeah. So the way to work with it is to kind of compensate this by a formula. So the formula is the follows. We go in the nth step, yeah. We take the random direction, and we compensate it by we shift this random direction closer to the middle, such that the shift depends on the number of steps we should go. Yeah. So such that in one step, the expectation would be to go precisely according to the probability distribution. And this indeed affects only the drift. Yeah, was it clear, the answer?
Not entirely, I'm afraid. So when you say you change you compensate, I'm not exactly sure how the compensation works.
The compensation goes as follows. So suppose you have n step walk.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So then suppose your measure is distributed such that it's not symmetric. Yeah.
Yes.
So now you take the velocity vector and subtract of this the expectation of the measure.
Okay, right.
Yeah, multiplied by a coefficient which depend on n.
On n, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the coefficient is linear, depends on n, and is chosen such that for n equal to 1, it simply sends a point to correctly distributed.
Yeah. Okay, no, I'm with you. Thanks so much.
Would the other questions or comments?
I could ask a question.
Yeah, Ross, you're welcome.
There's a big theory of random walks, of course. Probabilists know about where, for example, you don't need to assume a finite variance, which I understand is essentially incorporated in your assumptions in some way. So, for example, you can have a random walk attracted to a stable wall. So I'm wondering if there are probably some fairly obvious generalizations of your results to this sort of situation.
So I didn't understand one word. So if you take random walk, adapt it, and then I didn't understand the word.
Sorry, I didn't catch what you said.
I didn't understand the example you would like to suggest. So
well, put another way, the what you've done is based on a square root rate of attraction to the normal distribution. But it's possible to have other kinds, attraction to other kinds of distribution with different rates, different norming and possibly centering rates on your random walk.
I'm afraid I don't understand terminology. So the measure inside the space of directions can be arbitrary. So it should be probability, of course. Good to have a centered, though, as I said, that's not necessary, but otherwise it is not kind of normally distributed here. Yeah. Of course, if you kind of do many steps, there would be a kind of normal distribution due to central limit theorem, but generally it is not assumed to be normal distributed. So is it?
I'm not sure we're talking about the same thing really, but when I see the square root normalization in your formulation, then I think, okay, we could have n to some other power than a half.
So what place you're speaking about?
So if say, if I understood Ross' question correctly, so if you consider a different random walk, where instead of normalization by square root of n, you use another type of normalization.
Ah, okay. So, this case,
probability limit would be different. So could you just tell something about such cases? Ross, am I correct what you want?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for the help. So you want to kind of make here different normalization, yeah?
Yes. Your random walk, of course, would, I'm not sure how this would be formulated, but the whether it's the conditions on the manifold that you're looking at, or the geometric setup, or whether it's part of the stochastic setup.
Well, maybe you can help me and tell what happens if, in the case of the standard Pearson random walk, you take other normalization here. I kind of afraid that if you take it wrong, if it's higher than square root of n or is lower than square root of n, I mean, if it's asymptotically not a square root of n, then you either always escape to infinity or always converge to a point. Is it not true?
Yes, that would certainly happen in your setup. But if you have a different setup where the it's a different random walk, right? It has a different kind of a behavior, which matches the normalization is chosen to match the large deviation behavior of the random walk.
Mm-hmm.
This is very classical in random walk theory.
So one can try to do it. I don't know how one can try, for example. So the one of those questions, whether one can find a geometry which is good enough to kind of measure this deviation, yeah. And what comes in mind is possibly one can take the Fitzgerald metric such that the length of the spheres of the circles of the spheres, the volumes of spheres grows much higher than that of the flat metric and that of the metric of bounded geometry. So one possibly can try, let me just try to write the formula without guarantees that you understand it. So the formula would be the following: take the main case, so we take dr square plus f of r d theta square. Here r and theta can be thought to be standard polar coordinates on the plane. Yeah. Now the place we can play with is the function f of r. So to get flat case, f of r is equal something like sinus square. But if no, it is to get constant curvature. Flat case is, it is r square, yeah? But if this big function f grows very fast, yeah? If the function f grows very fast, then possibly one can, or just maybe function which is zero almost every, possibly one can make another rate of this normalization, yeah. So maybe it will have sense. It is.
Yes,
so
I think that's the key way to think of it. And you would then have convergence not to a Brownian motion, but to some other kind of process, for example, a stable process.
Okay, stable process, yeah. I do not have enough expertise to answer your question. For me, stable process should somehow be, I don't know. Ah, okay, now I understand what I say. And your configuration space is compact, yeah? So basically you live on something compact and you move quite fast, but because everything compact, I mean, everything's homogeneous. Yes?
Yes.
One can do it, yeah? Then probably the theorem survives. We didn't consider it, but it's very interesting question, topic, yeah? And yes. Basically, you know, it's just look on the history, yeah? The setup which we worked in, which we solved, is extremely natural, yeah? It is just standard, the most standard stochastic process adapted to some other background, yeah?
Yes.
It appears to be some technical question, technical issues with it, and probably because of it, it was not done before. And similar story would be with any other natural standard question, say the one you ask, adapted to a Finsterian or to any other non-standard background. It would be some technical topics. It is interesting, and yes, one need to find a geometer and suggested him to do this problem together. It's very sensible thing.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, looks like Andrei has already left us, so I will take over. So maybe, if there is more interest in asking further questions, we could afford one more question. If not, then maybe we should thank our speaker again and call it a day. So maybe another quick question.
So. So in the Brownian in the Riemannian case, the limiting process is as you mentioned is canonical in the sense that it does not depend on the choice of your random direction, and it depends only on this geometric Laplacian. But on the Finsler in the Finsler case, somehow as you've shown, the limiting object depends on the choice of these random directions that you put on the tangent spaces. So can you give us some insight about how this dependence arises? Why in the Riemannian case you don't see such dependence, while in the Finsler case you do end up with such kind of dependence?
Let me find a place first to make a picture. Probably here is there some place. Let me just reformulate your question, yeah? So suppose you have a Riemann metric and a Fislerian metric, yeah? And the information to give Riemann metric is just, yeah, is a matrix, yeah? And Fislerian metric, how it's given? Well, it is given by a convex wall around the region, yeah? It contains all information about Riemannian metric and Finsterian metric at the point, yeah? Now, suppose you would like to have a construction which is Korn independent of a measure or maybe probabilistic measure constructed by the help of the metric G. And by the help of the metric F, yeah? Because of construction should be Korn independent, it should naturally be invariant with respect to the action of the group S O N, of the group of the isomorphs of the metric G at one point, which is just the usual bilinear form, yeah? Now, it is easy statement that a measure which is invariant with respect to the group of S or N, a rotational symmetric measure. It's not one, but there is only one functional freedom inside, and they correspond to the same Laplace operator. So they will give you the same output. So the measure, the density of the measure, it's true also in the non-smooth case, the density of the measure would be simply any function depending on the distance to the zero point multiply to the usual volume form, to the Lebesgue volume, to the density of, so the density would be simply retentional invariant function, yeah? And so there are many retentional invariant function, yeah? So they will give the same, essentially the same random walk, only the representation of the time will be different. Now, in the Fissler case, if you have a convex ball, then the group of isometry of the convex ball, it's actually smaller than S or N, which implies the existence of different measures canonically constructed by F, which constructed by coordinate invariant procedure. So if we give you one construction, it was you take the measure which is proportional to the Lebesgue measure inside the ball. So it is one of them. But the other one could be, well, also gives the other one. So take our function f, take its square, and take its second differential. Yeah, it will be a metric because function is strictly convex. It is positive definite metric. So the volume form of this metric restricted to our Fissler ball give you properly normalized to get probability measure, give you the measure. But there are many others. So one can, of course, interpolate between these two measures. But there are many others. So the geometric reason is because the group of linear automorphism of a convex ball is very small. And in particular, is convex ball has no symmetry at all. So in the case that the group of automorphism of it, linear automorphism, is just trivial, you really can take any measure inside this guy, and it will be just a canonical construct measure. Yeah.
Thank you. That's quite clear.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
All right. So maybe that will be it. So thank you very much, our speaker, for giving talk. Very good one. And thanks for the audience to the audience for asking questions. So thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.